Hello students, welcome to the lesson 5 of the chapter 6 from the subject Advanced Structural Analysis. So in this lesson, we will see the generalized procedure of FEM. So basically how to solve a problem using your finite element method, that is what we will be seeing in this particular lesson or steps involved in finite element method. So let's get started. So the first step is to create the structure of continuum using geometric modeling techniques. So whichever structure you want to analyze, first you need to create it in the form of a continuum using any geometric modeling technique or application, right? So once you have created the geometric model that has to be analyzed, next step, you have to discretize the structure. So what is discretization? Discretization is nothing but dividing the structure into finite elements. So you can decide on the number of finite elements based on the complexity of the problem, right? So you have to remember few things. So the finite elements can be triangular, quadrilaterals for a two-dimensional continuum. And if it is a three-dimensional analysis, the finite elements may be hexahedron or tetrahedron. Now types of elements will anyways be dealing in the next lesson. Okay, for now you have to know that if it is a two-dimensional continuum, you have to divide the finite element into triangles or quadrilateral, and if it is a three-dimensional analysis, you have to use the hexahedron or the tetrahedron. Now next one more thing is this mesh generation. So whenever you have to do your discretization in any software, you have to use a program called mesh generation program. It's also known as pre-processing unit. Okay, this will help us to do the discretization technique. So mesh generation is a program known as pre-processing unit, help the users in doing this work. In doing what work? In doing the discretization work. So once the structure is ready, you have to discretize the structure using the mesh generation technique. So after that, the next step is to specify the approximation equation. So once the number of finite elements are decided, you have to specify the approximation equation for each element. So the order of the approximation can be either quadratic, that is your power 2, or linear, that's your power 1. Okay. Should be specified, and the equation should be written in terms of the unknown nodal values. Whatever are the unknown displacement or nodal values, we have to write the quadratic equation in the form of, we have to write the approximation equation in the form of your unknown nodal values. Okay, so as I told, we have to write the approximation function for each and every element. Say for example, if this is a structure and you are dividing the structure into 8 elements, you have to write 8 approximation equations, one for each element. So if it is a very complex structure, there will be lakhs or thousands or lakhs of elements. So for each and every element, you need to write the approximation equation. So using software will become easier because it will write on its own. You don't have to do it manually. So this is your third step. First step is create the structure. Second step is discretize the structure into finite elements. Third step is to write the approximation equation. Next, moving on to the fourth step, we have to determine the shape function for each element. Okay, shape function n we have to determine for each element. So in the next coming classes, we will see how to calculate shape functions for different types of elements. Okay, manually. So this is what we have to do when we are doing it in the process of your FEM. Once we decide the approximation function, we need to find the shape functions for each element. Okay. Once the shape functions are found, the next step is to formulate the properties of each element. So whatever properties you want to give, you have to give it for each element by formulating the property. Then step 6 is to determine the stiffness matrix K and the equivalent load vector. Okay, so equivalent load vector, call it as PL. in this case. Okay, so we have to determine the stiffness matrix and the equivalent load vector of all the elements. So what you have to remember while doing this is your stiffness matrix consists of coefficients of equilibrium equation that are derived from the geometric and material properties of the element. So based on the geometric and material property of the element, you have to use the equilibrium equation to find the coefficients of your stiffness matrix or the stiffness matrix. Okay, normally we obtain this using the principle of minimum potential energy. So we use the principle of minimum potential energy for obtaining the coefficients of your stiffness matrix. So equivalent load vector, you can find it based on the loads which are coming up on the structure, right? This is your step 6. Moving further, step 7 is to assemble the elements in order to obtain the finite element model of the continuum. Now, till now, we have discretized, and for each element, we have calculated your shape function, stiffness matrix, equivalent load vectors and all. Now, we need to assemble them to form your original structure or original finite element model so that it becomes a continuum back again. Right. So that is your step 7. Assembling everything is your step 7. Then moving on to step 8, we should apply the known load nodal forces or moments, whatever are there. If we are going for stress analysis, we have to apply the nodal forces and moments. And if you are going for heat transfer analysis, we have to apply the nodal heat flux. This is important. Nodal heat flux in case of heat transfer, nodal forces and moments in case of your stress analysis. We have to apply these. Then once we apply, we have to apply the boundary conditions whatsoever are in the structure. So in stress analysis, we should specify how the structure is supported. Basically, you have to give the support conditions if they are your stress analysis, like your structures, which support, hinged, roller, whatever. Those type of supports you need to specify, right? This involves what will happen if you have to give a support condition, which is nothing but giving nodal displacements to known values like 0. Say for example, if this is the support which you have to give, that is a fixed, so if it is a fixed support, nothing will be 0 here because it will have a horizontal reaction, it will have a vertical reaction, and it will also have a moment. Say for example, if you are going to give the support as a hinge, so what will you make 0? It will have horizontal reaction, it will have vertical reaction, but the rotational value m will be equal to 0. So this, if you set to 0 m, it is automatically understood that it is a hinge support. So that is how we have to give the nodal displacements for giving support conditions in case of stress analysis. Suppose you are doing heat transfer analysis, we should impose all known values of nodal temperature. Wherever nodes are there, whatever is the temperature of each node, we have to give the temperature for each node, right? So that is what we'll do in your heat transfer analysis. So step 9 is applying your boundary condition based on the type of problem you have. Then moving on, step 10 is to solve your linear algebraic equations. All whatever linear algebraic equations you have, you might have had them in your partial differential equations. By doing all the above steps, they have been converted into your linear algebraic equations. Now you have to solve them to get your nodal degrees of freedom. Okay, so whatever are the unknowns, to get them you have to solve your linear algebraic equation. So the unknowns in stress analysis will be nodal displacement, and the unknowns in your heat transfer analysis will be what? Your nodal temperatures. So you can easily find this by solving the linear algebraic equation. Right. Once you are done with that, you have to calculate the element strains from the above displacements, whatever you have got, or nodal temperature, whatever you have got, you have to find your element strains. So in stress analysis, for calculating element strains from the nodal degrees of freedom and the element displacement field interpolation. So what we have to do, finally we have to calculate the stress from the strains, right? So once we get the strain, you have to find the stress, right? So in heat transfer analysis, what will happen? We should calculate element heat fluxes from the nodal temperature, whatever we have obtained, and element temperature field interpolation has to be done. Okay, here displacement will we have to do. Here what we have to do? Temperature we have to do. So this is your 11th step. Then the final step is your interpretation of the results. So all the results will be obtained after doing this analysis. Then whatever the results you have obtained, that you have to interpret. So the interpretation of numerical results in terms of their physical and mathematical significance. This we have to do. The system will not be able to do it. We have to do it based on our experience. Now, an important part of this step is to assessment of the discretization and modeling error. So this is an important part. If there are any modeling error or any discretization problem, we need to assess it and repair it. If there are no problems, then we have to go ahead with the analysis. So this last step is very, very important. That is your interpretation of the result for your engineering application. Okay. But the importance of this cannot be emphasized so easily, because it varies based on the complexity of the problem. So these are the 12 steps which you have to follow when you are solving a problem using your finite element method, or when you are analyzing a structure using your finite element method, be it manual or be it using your FEM software. These are the procedure which has to be followed. So if in the exam they ask, you can write these 12 steps. Or for a little more easier explanation, I have another set of procedure which you can write. So we'll see how to do that. So you can write those 12 steps, or also you can write these steps which I am doing further. Okay. So the first step is discretization. Already the model will be there. You have to do the discretization. So what is discretization? The art of subdividing the structure into convenient number of smaller elements. Right. This is nothing but your discretization. So the smaller elements can be of three types: 1D element, 2D element and 3D element, right? So if it is a 1D element, it is nothing but your bar element. It has only two. The simplest form of 1D element is a line element with two nodes. This is your node number 1 and this is your node number 2. Okay. So the beam and bar is considered to be your 1D element. Next, moving on to 2D elements, the triangular shape and the rectangular shape are considered to be 2D elements because it has two dimensions, one x and one y, right? Here only one dimension will be there, x. The y dimension will be neglected. Understood, right? Now, the simplest form of the 2D element is what? It is a triangular element. It has all corner nodes. Here also rectangular elements also has your corner nodes. So these are your 2D elements. Coming to the 3D elements, these are in three dimensional. They have x, y and also z. These are used for three dimensional stress analysis problems. So the simplest form is what? The one which has all the corner nodes here. So hexahedral and tetrahedral elements are the examples for your three dimensional elements. There are n number of one-dimensional, two-dimensional, three-dimensional elements, but these are the basic types. So this is your step 1, that is discretizing the structure into known into required number of finite elements. The elements can be of any three types: 1D, 2D, or 3D. So step 1. Moving on to the step 2, we have to number the nodes and elements. So once we divide the structure, we have to number all the nodes and we have to number all the elements. So it, because this numbering is important, because based on this number only, a stiffness size of the stiffness matrix will be decided. So if there are 5 nodes, the size of this stiffness matrix will be what? Say for example, 5 nodes are there. If 5 nodes are there, now the number of elements will be 4, one less. So the size of this stiffness matrix here in this case will be 4 into 4. So that's why it's important to decide on the numbering of the nodes and elements. So what will happen, you have to properly, and one more thing is you have to properly number the elements. Only once you do proper numbering, the memory requirement will be less and the problem can be solved easily. If you randomly do the numbering, it will become very difficult. Say for example, this is your element, I call this node 1 and node 2. Now we discretize this into say 3, 4, 5. These are your nodes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are your nodes. This 1, 2, 3 and 4 are your elements. So if you do it in a certain order, the easily analysis can be solved. If you randomize it and write the numbering wherever you want, the analysis will become a slightly difficult. Okay. Then condition for numbering. So how many numbers are important is maximum node number minus minimum node number should come to a minimum value. Only then whatever your numbering you have done will be in proper order. So this is your step 2. Next, moving on to step 3, we have to select a displacement function or a interpolation function, nothing but your approximate function what we have discussed here. Okay, so for each element we need to decide the displacement function. So the displacement function can be what? Algebraically linear, quadratic or cubic. Linear is power 1, quadratic is power 2, cubic is power 3 and so on. It can go on increasing, right? So if you observe phi of x, if it is linear, a1 plus a2x. So if it is a polynomial, what will happen? X and y, two terms will come, a1 plus a1x plus a2y. So this is a polynomial type. Okay, here again in polynomial type, they will be of varying, quadratic, cubic and so on will come into picture. Right. So if you want to write quadratic, that will be phi of x is equal to alpha naught alpha 1x plus alpha 2 x square. If it is cubic, what will happen? One more term will come, alpha 3 x cube will come. Okay, like this will go on. You can go on writing your interpolation functions. So that's your step 3. Moving on to the step 4, you have to define the material behavior. So this is done using what? Your stress strain displacement or the strain displacement or the stress strain relationship. Based on your strain displacement and stress strain relationship, you can decide your material behavior. Okay, for example, if it is a 1D problem, one dimensional problem, like a beam or like a bar element, for example, a bar element, if you take the strain displacement relationship is given by what? E is equal to dou u by dou x, where E is your strain, u is your displacement field, which is varying in your x direction. Since it is only one dimensional, you have only one. Suppose if it is a two dimensional, what will happen to your strain displacement relationship? It will be dv square by dx square. Here it will be two dimensional, where v is your displacement in the field variable along y direction. Understood? So this is how the stress strain or the strain displacement relationships are given. Based on those, you can define your material behavior. Anyways, these we will see in the further examples, problems when we have solved it. Okay. So this is your step 4. Moving ahead, step 5 is to define the element stiffness matrix and the equation. So the equation which we use for finding the element stiffness matrix is F is equal to KU, all power E. E is nothing but for each element. F is what? Vector of nodal, element nodal forces. K is what? Element stiffness matrix. U is what? Element displacement vector. Now, these equation is derived from what? Either your Glycin's method or variational method or your direct equilibrium method. So this is how you will define all your element stiffness matrices. So once you define all your element stiffness matrices, you have to assemble the equation to get your global or your total equation. See, capital F is equal to K into capital U. So this is your assembled or the global equation what you have. Okay. After doing the individual element, you have to add it up or sum it up to get this particular values. Well, the parameters in this are related to your global parameters or the entire structural parameter. Right. Then is your step 7, where you have to apply the boundary conditions. So applying boundary conditions will come in the last. So the details of what are the boundary conditions, we have already discussed in the previous procedure. Right. So we have to apply the boundary condition and obtain the solution for your unknown displacements. Understood? See, your boundary conditions are applied so that the structure remains in place instead of moving as a rigid body. Right? Once from the set of algebraic equations formulated from your previous steps is solved and the unknown value of u is determined. Normally we do this using your Gauss-Seidel method. there are many methods, Gauss elimination method, Gauss-Jordan method. You can use any method you want, but majorly Gauss-Jordan method is used. Okay, this is your step 7. Moving ahead, the step 8 is the computation of your element stresses sigma and your element strain E from whatever nodal displacement you have obtained. Understood. So this is a very important factor. Displacement is not the only one we want. We want the stress and the strains in the elements. Understood. So these are the steps. The last step, 9th step, is interpolation of the result, which is also called as post processing. So once the results are obtained, you need to interpret it graphically and decide on what are the designs you have to make, what are the decisions you have to make. Now, for doing all these finite element methods, there are so many different softwares, which are your ANSYS, Abacus, SAP, MISA, SAM80. So there are n number of finite element methods using softwares, right? From this we can do the analysis. So either you write the first 12 steps of your analysis procedure which I have said you, or if you want an easier version, you can write these 9 steps which are there in detail, with the formulas are also given here, or combine both of the procedures proper in a proper way and write the answer. Is it clear? So these are the steps involved. So in the next class we'll see about the next topic, what is available for your finite element method.